Hello again. Welcome to the second video in the series. In the first one, I emphasised how the PACE team ignored all hard evidence that CBT and graded exercise did not improve the real-life performance of people with ME, but that they just got carried away with their ability to change the way that people answer questionnaires a little. That's really all you need to know. But this second video explains just how badly they understood what they were supposed to do with the data. Despite using very sophisticated push-button statistics, they really didn't know the rules for even the very basic stuff. And that's important. They want us to see them as experts, but the mistakes they made were appalling. Don't worry though, it's very easy to understand. So easy, even an author of the PACE trial should be able to understand it. But remember, I'm just showing you how poor the analysis was. The questionnaires were unreliable anyway. What was your score on the questionnaire? They only accepted patients with scores of 65 or below. There were quite a few patients whose illness was less severe and who scored more than that. They were not involved in the trial. The target on this questionnaire for recovery was originally set at 85. It's a bit on the low side for healthy folk, but lots of people with ME would be overjoyed to reach those scores. They explained that it was important to set a gap between the entry score and the target. But after the trial had ended and all the data was in, they decided to lower the target to 60. Yes, that's right, 60, below the entry level. So someone could have joined the trial with a score of 65, dropped to 60 by the end of the trial, and yet still hit the recovery target. How did they justify this? Well, first of all, the maths teacher in me needs to emerge and give you some background information. Sorry. I'll try not to be scary. The patients in the trial were aged between 18 and early 60s, and none had any other serious health issue. In 1999, Professor Anne Bowling collected lots of results from this and similar questionnaires for a vast range of people, and they looked at that data for comparisons. Obviously, to work out a recovery target, you would need the results of people of a similar age range who were relatively healthy to see what their scores were like. The PACE folk used data that included people who were in their 90s and people who had long-term chronic illnesses. How on earth could that be used as a comparison? No statistician would allow you to do that. If I told you that the average height of an adult male was 5 feet 10 inches, plus or minus 3 inches, you would take that to mean that most men were between 5 feet 7 inches and 6 feet 1 inch. In fact, more precisely, it would mean that 2/3 of men were in that range and that 1 in 6 men were shorter than 5 feet 7 inches and 1 in 6 were taller than 6 feet 1 inch. There are strict rules in statistics about when you can do such calculations, and we teach this to 15-year-olds. You can use the calculation that way if the data is nicely balanced on both sides, as it is with heights. We call it a normal distribution. If you had 10 people, one of whom had been born with no fingers, then if you used that method, the average works out at 9 plus or minus 3. There's no way that you can claim that the average person had 9 fingers and that most had between 6 and 12 fingers. You must never use it in situations like that. When the data is badly skewed, it gives silly answers. Here is a graph of the scores of around 1,300 people of working age who did not have a long-term health condition. This is the data they should have used. There are some low scores, But remember that this will include, for example, people who are very overweight. You can see that most people scored 95 or 100. No surprise there. Here is a graph of the scores that they actually used. You can see how there are many more low scores, but still most folks scored 95 or 100. The PACE team worked out that the average from this data, It came to 80 plus or minus 20. So they decided that it meant that two-thirds of the scores were between 60 and 100. So they set the target at 60 because, according to them, that's where many of the healthy folk of working age would be. I mean, just look at the graph. That claim is rubbish. The middle score is 95. Most of the scores are between 90 and 100. One of the first things that you teach statistics students is to look at the data and see that your statements are sensible. There are strict rules preventing you from doing this in statistics. If my sixth formers had done something like this in their projects, I'd have gone home despondent. Yet we are told that this study is of top quality. Let's be honest, this is not a matter of opinion or a question of interpretation. It is wrong, black and white. Clearly, scientific analysis and statistical techniques are skills that the supporters of CBT have yet to acquire. But please don't take this to mean that the whole trial has to be scrapped. Lots of the data could be valuable, if we were allowed to see it. Only half of the patients had ME, the others appeared to suffer mainly from depression. It would be useful to see how the different groups performed on the real-life measures. But of course, the PACE trial authors resist any efforts from us to see any more data. Data from a study that we, the taxpayer, funded. I wonder why. I am still truly shocked by how bad their analysis was, and by the almost total reluctance of experts in the UK to criticise it. You'd almost believe that there was still an old boys' network operating in the medical profession.